While Elementor is working on a classes feature, which we know from other page builders like Bricks, where you can manage all your visual things in a global way, some companies don't want to wait for Elementor and they build something themselves. What I'm going to show you right now is not a classes feature, but it is a plugin that allows you to manage things on a global level, which was not possible before. It's called Stylekits for Elementor from a company called AnalogWP, and they have a few features already in the free version, which are pretty cool. I'm thinking of implementing this plugin in my own workflow, so this is just my opinion. I'm not paid to make this video. I did approach them to get a license for the pro version, which they gave me, which is really nice, but to be honest, I think the free version is just good enough for 80%. So let me show you a few features that I really liked. The first one is the background color changer. So when you have a section like this, you can easily change the light background to a dark background if you want by a simple drop down. How cool is that? So that you don't have to click on each individual widget and container to change the colors. A spacing preset, which gives you some options to change the padding on any kind of section. And then you can also change those values globally, and even put in clamp if you want to. A Stylekit library that lets you change the design of your whole website with just a simple dropdown. So this is how my website looks right now, but then I can change my kits to something else, for example, mono type dark. I click on OK. I refresh my page and it's a completely different style. And then they also have templates over here that are actually useful because most templates are overly designed. But these ones are pretty simple, which is always what you want. And they adapt the style of the actual kit, as you can see. So you don't have to change the colors and everything to make it fit your design. And everything I've showed you right now is all in the free version, but it's not perfect, of course. So let's see if it's worth it to sacrifice having another plugin on your website for a little bit better workflow. In order to show you how this works, I have a brand new website over here with only Elementor hosting a plugin for the hosting and manage WP so I can easily log in. So you can find it by clicking on add new and searching for Stylekits. Actually, that's what you're thinking. But then if you press, you can't find it. You need to add a space for some reason, but whatever, you can install it, activate it, and then it shows you a few things that you have to activate. Elementor, of course, container, you should activate the container. You can disable Elementor's default colors and fonts because they have their own set of colors and fonts. Install and activate Hello Theme. I haven't done it on this website, which is nice. Import a starter theme style preset. Let's just try it and see what they're actually doing. All right, we click on open the new template and see what it actually creates. So this website now has the container and it has created a test page. But I want to go back for a moment to see what it has done. Okay, the plugin is here and it has created a saved template over here, a test page. But you can of course also create a new page. What I've done here, I've created the home page and let's test it. So this website is brand new. So if you go to global colors, you can see that these ones are now deactivated because Stylekits wants you to use their colors. This is not the same for fonts. You still have the primary, secondary text and accent, but they also have Stylekit fonts over here. So with fonts, you can use your Elementor fonts. But if you really like this plugin, then I would recommend to put all your custom fonts in here. I have made a video about how to set up your fonts a few weeks ago. If you want to see that, click the video in the card or in the description, because setting up fonts is not that easy, especially not for responsiveness. And you have this new option over here called Stylekits with the same icon as the site settings have, which I think is not very good. Maybe they could just add their little logo over here, because now it kind of looks like you have two kind of site settings, even though you also have styling for buttons over here, which you also have over here. Just a little bit of feedback. Let's start with the background color classes. So here you can see you have a light background preset, a dark, and an accent. So by default, the light background already is connected to one of the global colors, their set of colors. And then text, which is body text, and headings is for the titles. And on dark, it's inverted. The text and the headings are both white. So what that means is that when you have a section like this, you can go to style and then over here, a dropdown should appear, but it only appears if you click on classic, because it needs to have a background in order to show that. So then if you switch it to light, it will use the light background, and then you switch it to dark, and then it turns to dark. And if you just keep none on white and you keep this for your light color, because most websites have a white, a soft color background and a dark one, then you still have three options even though you're in the free version. So this is kind of like a hack I came up with because in the free version they only give you two options, but the none is actually white, so then you still have three options, which is pretty cool. So backgrounds are easy to change, and that's the same for the padding. So right now in my own projects, I created my own classes, but then you have to write some CSS in order to manage your classes on a global level, which of course defeats the purpose of Elementor because it's a no-code tool, right? We rather not use code at all, and that's possible with the spacing preset. So default is the default that Elementor has, so that's kind of like 10 pixels, I think. No padding, of course, is absolutely no. XL is big, and then it goes down to small. They already gave it names. You can change those if you want to. So let's say that we have two primary sections, right? We have a section like this. We have another section which has a dark background like that. And then at some point we're like, you know what? This needs to be a little bit bigger. So you go into Edit in Stylekits. It goes immediately to the site settings. And then if you go to container spacing, here you can see the presets. They have put in pixel values, but if you want to, you can just change that to rem or even create your own clamp feature. For some reason right now, it doesn't work. I don't know why. Maybe they should take a look at that, because when you select this option, it should just give a full input field. But you can, if you want to, change it to rem, which is better than using pixels. So for example, you can put in 7, but keep in mind that it also adds right and left padding. So I would not recommend using that, because for your sections, you only need top and bottom, right? So you can put in the values that you want here and change them afterwards. So right now, if I say all of the sections are gonna be 4, then all of the sections that have XL will go to 4 rem. By the way, if you don't know what rem is and the difference between rem and pixels and EM, then also watch my typography video, because I explained that over there. And like I said, you can change the names over here. So for most websites, I think you only need 3 top and bottom padding styles. Because you have a big one for your heroes, then you have for normal sections like this, and sometimes for smaller sections, maybe 4, but I would limit it to keep your design consistent. But for cards, so designs like this, where there are different cards in a grid, for example, so then you can use the other ones over here, or you can even make new ones. So here it says style 6. So you can keep these settings and then make a new style, because they give you 3 more for free. And you could be like card design 1. Right, and you put in some values, because for the card we do need to use all sides, because let's see, in my design I have 30 30, so we're gonna put in 30. All right, so we're gonna click on update, we're gonna go back, we're gonna import something that has looks like a card, for example an icon box. We're gonna go to advanced, we're gonna give it a background in order to give it some color. And now instead of adding the padding over here, we're just gonna go over here. And unfortunately, as you can see, there's no padding option over here. So then you will still need to use classes. So like I said, it's not perfect, but let's say that you don't give the widget a background, right? But you add a container, and then you add your widget in the container, and then you give your container a background, then you can use the spacing preset, which we just created. Right now it doesn't show. I think I need to refresh. I'm gonna do that. I'm gonna click Command Shift R, click on it again, and there it is, card design 1. Boom, 30 pixels. Great. Let's duplicate this one to see if it works if we change the Stylekits again. So we're gonna scroll down, and card's design, you know what, is now gonna be 20. As you can see, it updates in all places. And in the free version, they give you 1 to 8 options, which I think is more than enough. 9 to 16 or 70 to 24. You don't need that much spacing on a website. Actually, using less spacing styles is better for consistency. So just try to keep it in 8. 4 top and bottom and 4 cards, it's more than enough. And this is all free. So let me quickly make a design that's a little bit nicer. I'm gonna put these containers in a row. Okay, so I've changed up the design a little bit. I've added a container over here with 3 containers in it. And in these containers are the icon boxes. And we can still change the background container if we want to, for example, a dark background. It doesn't understand what's inside of it. So again, it's not perfect. And then you can click on each individual container and put it on dark, but it doesn't work because the color is still selected. I think they should fix this, that it should automatically disconnect, because if you disconnect it, then it works and it automatically even inverts the icon box that's inside of it. Look at how cool that is, guys. And now I've changed it, but we're still limited to only light and dark. So in the pro version, you have another option over here, but even that is not enough because in many of my designs, I have two background colors for light and two background colors for dark. So even three in the pro version is not enough. So that's a little bit of feedback for them. Okay, so let's go back a few steps because I want to show one more feature, and that is shadow style. So if you click on a container and you go to border, you have a new option over here called box shadow preset. Here are also presets that you can manage globally. So for example, let's say that I want a medium for this box. It automatically adds a shadow. Let's do that to the other ones as well. I'm copying the style like this, and then I'm clicking on the other one and using Command Shift V in order to paste it without having to right click. Okay, and now if I go in Edit in Stylekits, it automatically brings me to the Shadows tab. And here we have used medium on these boxes, so we can change the shadow over here. For example, change its color to purple. As you can see, it does work. And we can change the number over here. You can change it to the code, whatever you want. This is, by the way, the opacity. So you can, for example, change that to 50 if you want to make it more visible. And as you can see, it's very similar to the global padding feature. And again, you have 8 options, which is more than enough. I do not think that most websites have more than 8 kind of shadow styles. So I honestly do not understand why this is pro and this is pro, because this is more than enough. That's why I said I'm not really convinced of the pro version yet, to be honest, because the free version is already so good. Even though it's not perfect, it will save you some time. And I know a lot of you guys, you love the kind of videos that are more focused on workflow and doing things globally. So I think a lot of you guys will like this. Let's talk a little bit about the Stylekits now. I'm gonna click on update and I'm gonna go back to the backend. I'm gonna go to Stylekits. Let's see what this is all about. So what do we have right now? If you first click on local Stylekits, you can see that we now have base. As you can see, Stylekit base. You also have a default kit, but in the setup, I think they asked us to use a Stylekit, which is this one. You can change it if you go over here. But here you can see this is where almost all of their designs are pro, which is understandable. They have to make some money in some way, right? But let's just try to do another version, Slink, this one, import it. All right, where it is now, it's in the local style guides, like I said, over here. It's not activated yet. This is the drop down where you can activate it. So we're going to activate Slink. Let's see the difference. Let's open our homepage like this. All right, this is how our homepage looks. We're gonna click on apply, go back, refresh, and boom. But what happens? Let's open the page, because this Stylekit changing is not perfect, because what happens is that our preset is gone. So what it does is that it's actually removed our style that we created the padding class. Why? I just set this up, right? And it's the same with the colors and the fonts. It resets everything to this new Stylekit. So I'm not really big fan of it, because you can spend a lot of time setting up your, no, not this typography setting. Do not set it up over here. To set it up over here, right? You can spend a lot of time doing that, and then you change the kit, and then it removes all of the clamps, everything you've added, all of everything. I'm not a big fan of that. That being said, I'm not gonna use that feature at all, because I design my websites in Figma. But I wanted to show you this because I think it's pretty cool. This idea has some potential, but it should be implemented in a better way where it doesn't destroy all of your typography. And I understand it needs to change the typography, but this is kind of like where this tool also tries to be a design tool, even though it's a building tool. We're working with classes here, so I don't know. I'm not so sure about the Stylekits, but it looks really cool and it looks efficient. And maybe for the people that don't use Figma to design websites and just use Elementor to design websites, it's cool that you can change it in the beginning. But once you're gonna set up all of your styles and then you're gonna change it, you're not gonna be happy because it deletes everything. So that's an important thing that needs to be said. Okay, and like I said, you can now go to their template library, and these templates look different, but if you import them like that, then they will adopt the style of the new kits. So personally, I'm not gonna use this, the library Stylekits, but I am very happy with the spacing preset, the shadow presets, and the background changing feature. Let's see what the pro version is about. We're gonna go to their website, we're gonna click on pricing and scroll down and see what this actually is. So you get access to all of their templates, obviously. Like I said, you have more than 8 or 16 colors, but that's not really necessary. And they have the Stylekits front end switcher, I don't know what that is, and some other features. So I'm now gonna install the pro version of the plugin. So let's do that. Okay, you need to activate your license. I've done that right now in the settings tab. I'm also gonna install Elementor Pro just to make sure, because I think most people who use this plugin are already on Pro anyways. Okay, Elementor Pro and Stylekits Pro are now installed. As you can see, we can also now import all of the other styles. For example, do this one, looks pretty cool. View local Stylekits, what's the name? Rounder, apply, refresh, and boom, another website style. Okay, so what is the difference? We now have the accent color, which is cool. We now have more shadow options, but as I said, not necessary. Spacing, same thing. Oh, I forgot to tell you about the button sizes. This was already available in the free version. They have button sizes. I also want to give a little bit of feedback on this because I don't think it's that useful, because you don't see the actual padding that they used here, which is kind of annoying because I don't know how big it is. So what do I do? I have to reset the padding and then guess what the L was. And I don't use button sizes. What they should have is button styles. In the style guide that I use, that I created myself, I have button styles. That's what you actually want in a website, but not button sizes. Maybe you want to shrink it a little bit on mobile, but that's just a little bit of feedback. In the pro version, you also have a new option called user roles. You can limit what they can do. Is it useful? Yeah, it's good that there's some extra protection as Elementor Pro also has with user roles. So it's great that it's there. You also have extensions, activate or deactivate Unsplash collection libraries. I don't know what that is, but it's probably importing images from Unsplash. Not very useful for this plugin. But what I think might be interesting in the pro version is full WooCommerce integration. Because if you're going to use this plugin to change the whole styling of your website, you of course want all of the elements, including WooCommerce, to be affected by it. So I think that this is a worthy reason to upgrade. But Analog, if you're watching, give us button styles instead of button sizes. Give us more options over here, maybe even 4 or 6. So 2 in the free version, 6 in the pro. That will be a little bit more convincing than just one extra option. And maybe if it's possible, find a way to not reset all of the things and just the visual styles. I don't know if it's possible. If not, then I still think that this is a great product, especially the free version. If you want the pro version, there will be a link down below as always. Let's see their pricing. We're gonna go up to pricing. 1 license, 5 licenses and 1,000. Which makes this one, of course, very appealing compared to this one. But it's still 150 per year. Yeah, that's a price. I mean, Elementor is nowadays 400. Oh, right now there is a sale because of their birthday, but normally it's 400, as you can see. So do you want to spend this extra money per year to make your workflow a little bit nicer? You could do that. But hey, let's not forget, Elementor is working on the classes feature, which will allow you to create these kinds of styles for yourself. So I think in a year, maybe it's going to take them longer, and the same with the container, right? But I think in a year from now, we will be able to create these styles for anything in the same way as it is in bricks. So for some, it will be worth it to use it for a year and then cancel it. Then it will still work, but you cannot upgrade, and that can create problems. So to be really honest, I'm not really convinced about the pro version, unless they make a great separation between free and pro and maybe give us a lifetime deal so that we don't have to worry about breaking sites in the future. Or am I too pessimistic now? I don't know. I hope that you liked this video. I think it's a pretty cool tool. There are a few more videos coming up about new tools, which are also pretty cool, not as good as this one. And I want to end this video by saying that I'm always looking for new tools to improve my workflow. So if you've also found a cool tool that I should check out, put them in the comments below. Let me know what you think, and hopefully I will see you in the next video.